Good evening, and welcome back to the Royal Albert Hall. The 1986 season of promenade concerts is almost over. Tomorrow is the traditional and celebrated last night, and we hope, of course, that you'll join us for that. But the penultimate night, tonight, has its own tradition too. Ever since the days of Sir Henry Wood himself, this night has been the occasion for a performance of the Ninth Symphony by Beethoven. So we're about to hear this masterpiece, conducted by that very distinguished Beethovenian, Sir George Scholte. With soloists Jesse Norman, Sarah Walker, Rainer Goldberg, and Hans Sortin. And for the first time with this work at the Proms, a professional chorus made up of the BBC singers, London Voices, and the chorus of the Welsh National Opera. The orchestra is the London Philharmonic. Beethoven grew up in the age of Haydn and Mozart and inherited from them the classical 18th century Viennese tradition. As his friend Count Waldstein put it, he inherited Mozart's spirit from Haydn's hands. But the gradually increasing complexities of his life, his irascibility, his total inability to get on with other people, his general ill health, and specifically, of course, his deafness, quite the most appalling thing that could ever happen to a musician, all these caused him to write in a musical style that was correspondingly complex, profoundly individual, and astonishingly revolutionary. The Ninth Symphony, written just 3 years before his death, is possibly the most striking example of this dichotomy in Beethoven. On the one hand, it embodies the gesture and argument of 18th century classical style. But on the other, the innovations that it makes, both in structure and in profundity of personal expression, make the work a giant and complex compendium of a musical rhetoric that is at once agonized and triumphant. The Ninth Symphony is very much more than a symphony. It has its four movements, but not in the traditional order. Beethoven does begin with an allegro movement, albeit a very weighty one, but this is followed by the scherzo before the slow movement. And the celebrated finale, of course, breaks all conventions, adding a chorus and four vocal soloists and incorporating the text of the Ode to Joy by Beethoven's great contemporary, Schiller. And it's this, really, that is the key to the Ninth Symphony. Beethoven had known the poem since his early youth and had been intoxicated by its truly romantic philosophy of man's free will and liberty. So from the opening subterranean rumbles of the first movement, we move through conflict and destruction to the frantic momentum of the scherzo, to a sublime prayer and moment of repose in the slow movement, to the ultimate joyful explosion of the great vision of brotherhood in the finale. The Ninth Symphony is a symphony, an oratorio, an allegory, and a triumphant visionary statement all rolled into one. And as such, it must be among the very greatest achievements of the whole of Western civilization. Well, to be in charge of this Everest of musical creation must be one of the most dauntingly responsible tasks for any conductor. Yesterday I talked to tonight's conductor, Sir George Scholte. He's conducted the Choral Symphony many times over the last 35 years. I asked him whether it got easier or harder.
I think every music piece gets harder. The Beethoven 9 special gets harder every time. I conducted many times, but particularly the last 20 years, I was very keen not to get a cliche of it. So I conducted a few times and then put it aside. The last time, now, before that, it was about 6-7 years I didn't conduct Beethoven 9. I think it's very necessary that you conduct a few times to get a certain amount of clear picture of it and then put it aside.
Where is the focus, if there is one, do you think, of the Ninth? Do you keep the last movement in mind very much through the first three movements?
I would think that one, Jane. This, again, one shouldn't sound too grand, because I hate every grand sentence. I try to make movements by movements, building up movements, movements. Would be wonderfully interesting to know that when Beethoven started the Ninth Symphony composing, did he knew it that he must come to the finale composing a Schiller ode, also the words, or did he not? I think he did not. I believe that through the expressiveness of the piece, he find that there is nothing else after the third movement which you can say, which you can sing more than the human voice. I firmly believe that. It could be that that was a combination with his desire to combine that great love of humanity, embracing all the mankind. It could very well be that as both was, but and one certain knowledge we have that when he starts a last movement, he's going back to the quote himself. Very unique feature of Beethoven. Yeah. He quotes the first movement, he quotes the second movement, and the third movement. And the response of the cello double bass is less and less violent. When the first movement quotation comes, the cello double bass says, no, not that. I don't want that anymore. I'll go for somewhere else. And then the scherzo still says, not that. When the slow movement comes, the first time the cello double bass comes in piano, says in obviously veneering to something. And when the very faint quotation of the oboe and the bassoon of the joy motif comes, the answer is a jubilant. Yes, that's what I want. So if you look at it that way, very soon during the composition, he obviously knew that it will come to the last movement. Maybe immediately, I don't know. And we cannot ask him, unfortunately.
Sir George Scholte, talking yesterday about Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. And now we await the arrival of the leader of the London Philharmonic Orchestra, David Nolan. The soloist, the vocal soloist, will not be making their appearance until after the second movement. So now we merely await the arrival of the conductor for tonight's performance, Sir George Scholte. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Meine Freunde, Thank you.
The Symphony No. 9 in D minor, the Choral Symphony by Beethoven, performed there by the London Philharmonic Orchestra, leader David Nolan, conducted by Sir George Sholte. The soloists were Jessie Norman, soprano, Sarah Walker, mezzo-soprano, Rainer Goldberg, tenor, and Hans Sortin, bass, with the BBC Singers and the London Voices, chorus master Terry Edwards, and the chorus of the Welsh National Opera, chorus master Andrew Greenwood. Now to the platform, the soloists led by Jessie Norman, Sarah Walker, Rainer Goldberg, Hans Sortin, with the chorus masters, Andrew Greenwood and Terry Edwards, and Sir George Sholte, now bringing the choirs to their feet. And so we come to the end of our series of Friday evening proms on television. Tomorrow, Richard Baker will be here to introduce the last night of the proms. But from me for this year, and from all of us here tonight, with the audiences you can hear still exulting in the spirit of the triumph of human nature, good night.